design for submerged sills that our engineer came up with based on the 1972 U.S. Army Corps sill design, just so you know what we're talking about here. This is a hollow concrete structure that would be floated into position into the river, dropped into position where there is fish spawning habitat. It could be elevated off of the riverbed by about a meter to allow fish to swim through. This is done in proportion, so you can see 27-foot depth is needed for ships. The maximum height of those would be 32 feet. We consulted with U.S. Geological Survey, who survey the river every year, and would dive down with video cameras to monitor the spawning, particularly of lake sturgeon. And they have agreed that this is a suitable way to deal with the areas where the fish spawn. These submerged sills, if they were not needed, if by any chance we ever get high water levels again, can be floated, filled with air and floated to the surface and removed. Oh, sorry, I should have said they can also be rotated 90 degrees to lie with the flow. So I thought you might be interested in seeing this. Our engineer has overlaid on 2005 bathymetry of the St. Clair River. So again, here we have the Blue Water Bridge. This is Sarnia here and Port Huron. So this is 2005 bathymetry. And you can see these blue areas, that's where the river is eroding. And this is what they call a sand tongue that is slowly moving down the river. And as it moves down, it is scouring behind it. What's interesting is that the cells that they designed way back then, you'll notice that they're going right across these deep scour holes, which tells you that those scour holes were not there in 1972, because the submerged cells they designed then were solid concrete. They were not hollow. You cannot have a long sort of submarine-type concrete block that goes across the riverbed when it's 30 feet deep on one side and 60 to 70 feet deep on the other side. And that's how deep it is right now in this deep scour hole. It is this deep up here. They didn't recommend any here, but there are other cells they designed for up here. We don't have the bathymetry data for that area. So this tells the whole story of what was designed then, and the Army Corps are well aware of the fact that they would have to review this given the changes in the riverbed. And what needs to happen, too, is that these deep scour holes, where there is clay bottom, need to be stabilized and covered over with rocks. This is what our engineer has looked at, found other locations where shorter sills could be placed in the river. You can see these are the Army Corps designs, and they went farther down the river then. We had a meeting down in Bay City in Michigan. And we invited the Army Corps to come, and then they phoned and said, would you like us to present? And we said, that would be great. And then this hydrologist from the Detroit office phoned me and asked me, what would you like me to present? And I said, could you talk about past compensation designs and what authorization you might have? That was the end of November. We were stunned with what the information they provided at that meeting. We recently had a conference call with them that they confirmed that they do believe they have authorization, and they have sent it up the chain of command to Washington headquarters for the U.S. Army Corps. And this is the meeting we just had last Saturday down in Bay City, Michigan, because we know we need to bring Americans on side here. So these are a representative of U.S. organizations, and I just want to point out this one man to you right here. Ernie Krieger, who is a commissioner, which is basically, he's the head commissioner, like a mayor for Bay City. And he is the president of Save Our Shorelines, an organization that used to be opposed to doing anything about this. They have done a 180 and now are supporting restoration. And they are probably the biggest driving force in this new organization, representatives. But I think what we're particularly encouraged by, this man right here, Roger Gauthier, is a retired U.S. Army Corps hydrologist, also retired from the Great Lakes Commission. He is now chair of this new organization. He considers what has happened to you to be egregious, and he's decided to step forward and try to help us with this. So I thought you might be interested in seeing that. Just as follow-up, I will tell you that we are going to be in Washington next week during Great Lakes Days. The Great Lakes Commission have meetings, the Healing Our Waters Coalition, which is over 100 organizations around the Great Lakes. There are all kinds of meetings that we're organizing right now. With help from a law firm in Washington, we have meetings now with U.S. Senate and House leaders from the Great Lakes Task Force, a very powerful group of Senate and House leaders. It's nonpartisan. We have meetings with Chicago offices in Washington, with senior U.S. Army Corps people who will be responsible for giving final approval for submerged sails in the St. Clair River. I'm trying to remember who else. The Council of Environmental Quality, which is our door into the White House and the State Department. Because ultimately, as I said at the beginning, we need our Foreign Affairs Minister, John Baird, to communicate with John Kerry in the United States and figure out a way to send some money down to the U.S. Army Corps. We said to them in our conference call last week, if you were given provided some funding, could you proceed with this work this summer? The answer was yes. They might end up having to contract it out. And guess who they contracted out to? W.F. Baird and Associates, the coastal consulting engineers who did the original work for us identifying the erosion of the St. Clair River. So that was good news. We asked, their normal structure for getting funding would be through their budget requests, and they're working on their 2015 budget. We said that's way too far away. We need to get working on this now. There was another funding opportunity where they can get $3 million over 3 years, as long as their final report is not more than 3 inches thick. So we said, is that an opportunity? They said, yes, it is. But that's our reason. They told us who the senior people are in Washington, U.S. Army Corps headquarters, and we're going to be meeting with them next week. I have to tell you, this costs money. This costs a lot of money. For me to travel, for Roger to travel, I've not been able to find even B&Bs in Washington for less than $200 a night. So, you know, if this is going to happen, we are going to have to engage with America. We're going to have to engage with them fairly aggressively. So, I think that pretty well covers. I think I've said everything. I will say that the Great Lakes Protection Act has just been reintroduced and has just gone through second reading at our provincial government. It right now says nothing about water levels. I'm in a meeting tomorrow. The provincial government needs to engage in this. In order for those sails to go into the St. Clair River, Ontario issued a permit. They will likely have to reissue that permit because Ontario owns the lakebed. And our Ontario politicians should be putting pressure on our federal politicians. And our federal politicians need to get to our senior politicians. We have met with Tony Clement in Ottawa. He's aware of this. I need to update him right now. But the more pressure we put on the politicians, the better. Those of you who know about our restoreourwater.com website, I know some of you probably signed our petition. We now have over 7,500 names. We're printing that out, taking that to Washington, and we will be handing a copy to Tony Clement at an appropriate moment where we can get a photograph of him receiving that. So I'm happy to answer questions. If any of you got any suggestions, any way to help with this, let us know. I totally agree with the mayor. You need to all be speaking out very aggressively on this. Okay?
Just 1 second, sir. Okay. It's interesting. Mayor Jerry Marshall has joined us from the town of Penetanguishene. And Mayor, Jerry had a session with Mary 31st of January. Okay. And at that time, there were less than 5,000 signatures on that petition. The goal was to get to 5,000. They're now at 7,500. To have that many people go online within a month should give everyone in this room a clear indication that there is a movement afoot to make something happen. For far too long, the Americans just kind of turned a blind eye to it. If you were at the IJC meeting in Midland, that was kind of the message that came from the IJC was that everything was fine because it wasn't an American-based issue. Well, guess what? It's now on the other side. They're starting to be concerned. And one thing I know about Americans, because I have American relatives in my family, they're not going to stand still and be quiet about it. They're not going to be just say, well, okay, yeah, get around to it, maybe. They'll make a lot of noise. And it's great to hear that we now are in a position where we can kick it up the chain. Tony Clement has indicated, and Jerry Marshall was at a meeting in Harrisonville where a member of that staff said, yes, Mr. Clement will get the ear of the Prime Minister. Correct, Jerry? So there, this is what's been going on behind the scenes from the political side. We're pushing the ball. As I said off the top half hour ago, we need everybody to stand up and be counted. Go to that website, sign the petition. It would be great a month from now if we had 10,000 signatures on that. We had 5,000 a month ago, we're at 7,500. It would be great if we could get to 10,000 or 15,000 or 20,000.
I was very unhappy at the Midland meeting. And then after the meeting was over, various elected officials started speaking. And I noticed that as the elected officials came from smaller and smaller groupings, like the smaller town mayors, and then the shoreline administrations, they were much more violent and vehement in their denunciation of the IJC. You must have been there, sir.
I was there.
Yes, okay.
I was there too.
Well, I was not happy with the senior levels. They didn't say very much at all. I have a series of questions. Where is the water going? Who made that happen? Now, you touched on some of that. And who benefits from the water going where it is going now? My suspicion is that it's all south of the Canadian border.
It's not, but it goes through hydropower generation, both in the Niagara River and in the St. Lawrence River. And that is going to be a challenge for us going forward. Because we may not be able to generate as much power once we are able to maintain levels on Michigan Huron. During that phase-in period, once the levels reach a new equilibrium, everything will return to what it was before.
Will there be a new equilibrium?
Yes. The lakes will stabilize, yeah.
So do you...
Because we're going to stop the erosion, too, at the same time.
So
the water is basically the extra water. 10 billion gallons per day is going down the St. Clair River, down the Detroit River, through Lake Erie, out through Lake Ontario, out into the Atlantic.
Is that where it goes?
Oh, yes.
Does it sound like it diverted down to the Mississippi?
No.
Okay, I've been wrong then.
No. There is a diversion, but it's a fixed amount at Chicago, but guess what, folks? Because Lake Michigan water level is so low right now, they can no longer divert the amount of water that they're legally entitled to. And at Chicago, there are locks that open up into what is called the Chicago Sanitary and Shipping Canal. They don't treat their sewage. They send it south with, used to, Michigan water down into the Mississippi River. They can't do that right now. And the people in Chicago are starting to feel the effect of this, which is great. Because Rahm Emanuel calls his friend Obama in Washington, something might get done about this. And right now they're saying, oh dear, you know, the water in the canal is all getting polluted and stagnant, and we're going to have some algae growth as well. When the locks open, out goes their untreated sewage water onto water, Chicago's beautiful waterfront. That's not going to look pretty this summer. But the other, even more concerning, is that the Asian carp that are in the Chicago River will have a direct path out into Lake Michigan.
Okay, my last question is, when are you going to open up that jacket so we can see that beautiful t-shirt?
There we go. Thank you, sir.
I'm going to turn this way.
This is all non-Sierra Club. Chapters around the Great Lakes support restoration of Michigan Huron water levels. We will continue to expand. We want to go beyond just shoreline interests. The U.S. captains that guide ships through the Great Lakes, they have their own organization. And Roger Gauthier is actually on their board. We're going to bring them into this organization. Next week, when we're in Washington, we're going to be talking to U.S. lake carriers, because right now they're pushing for more and more money for dredging. Dredging is only a short-term solution to this. We need a long-term solution. So we will be working with them. I know Jim Weekly from U.S. Lake Carriers. We will be connecting with any organization that's expressing concern about this and getting them to join Restore Our Water International. Video with some of the people who spoke at the Midland meeting, if you want to watch that. Just restoreourwater.com.
Sandy?
Thanks, Mr. Mayor and Mary, for putting this on. And Mary, my question is, in the long term, if nothing is done, do you have a prediction as how low the water is going to go? Is it going to, like a bathtub, are we going to continue to drain the Georgian Bay and Lake Huron? Is it going to continue to go lower and lower?
Unfortunately, it is. W. Barrett Associates, just last fall, did some additional work for us pro bono. What they did was look at historic levels, look at climate change impacts, and go out with some prediction into the future. It is not pretty. And what they determined that was between 2000 and 2010, something very significant happened in the St. Clair River that increased its conveyance capacity even more. I suspect it was the winter of 2009 when there was an ice jam through the entire river, and I was down there, and there was a U.S. and Canadian ice cutter going up and down the river. As fast as they moved down the river, because of the flow, the ice just closed in behind them. And I watched it build up 3 and 4 layers deep, foot to 2 feet thick ice. When that happens, the river, the flow in that fast-moving river, has no other choice but to dig down, to get that volume of water through and scour it out. So that could be the time that that happened, but something very significant has happened. And the reality is, you know, it was way back in 2002 when I phoned a U.S. Army Corps staff person and said, do you know how deep the river is at the Blue Water Ridge? And he said, no, we haven't done any bathymetry work for 30 years. I mean, he was basically admitting nobody's been watching the storm. Nobody was watching what was happening. So I said, that would be interesting. I could, if you could do that. And he said, I'll send out a crew and we'll do some bathymetry work. So he phoned me back. He said, wow, I had no idea it was that deep. And he said, would you like me to see if I got the historic data? And I said, that would be great. He phoned me back. He said, well, I found some. But he said, it's at a different location than what we just did. He said, would you like me to redo it at the same location? And I said, yeah, that would be interesting. This is me and Canadian talking to U.S. Army Corps in the United States. So he sent back both the profiles, and we already had the engineers starting to work on it. They overlaid them and said, woo, we've got a significant change happening in the river. That was the basis of us doing further investigation, retaining there, raising the money for that initial report, taking it to the IJC. So nobody's been watching the storm. They don't even measure the flow in the St. Clair River right now accurately, completely. The USGS finally put a flow meter in the St. Clair River at the Blue Water Ridge. It reads two-thirds of the way across. We've been asking Environment Canada to put one in the same location, meet up with theirs. No, we still don't have one. So I said, so how do you figure out what the full flow value is for the St. Clair River? Oh, we extrapolate. And I said, isn't that just a nice word for estimate? And they said, yeah, I guess it is. So, you know, the other lakes, they measure the outflow on an hourly basis. They have flow meters regularly measuring it. Then they meet monthly and to set the discharge. We don't even know what the accurate flow measurements are for the St. Clair River, let alone the fact that it's eroding. If we hadn't brought this to the government's attention, I don't know what would be happening. But you're right, it's going to keep going down until we stabilize the river bed. Okay?